I will have to introduce myself. So I'm Florin Capitanescu and received a Master of Science degree in Electrical Power Engineering from the University Polytechnica of Bucharest, Romania in 1997. And then I obtained my PhD degree from University of Liège in 2003. My main research interests lie in the field of power system operation, planning and control, with particular emphasis on optimization method and somehow remotely voltage stability. So here I am. There were two nice presentations dealing with frequency issues. Now we move to something completely different, which is reactive power reserves, right? And the question I'm asking in this paper and this presentation is how, when this reactive power reserve, overall reserves in the power system would become scarce as we are transitioning toward renewable dominated or ideally 100% renewable supply. And try to come up with a methodology to try to assess this. The outline of the presentation is as follows. So first I will set clearly the context of this research work and will motivate it and will emphasize the main contributions. Then I would present a raw methodology, which is based on AC security constraint optimal power flow solutions. I would present some results with this methodology and I will end up the presentation with some conclusions and outlook. So let's set the context. You are aware that we are experiencing and will experience a lot of mutations in power systems, and these are basically driven by the agreed targets on renewable energy sources integration. The consequences of this mutation would be that we are going to displace large fossil fuel-based conventional power plants with a myriad of small renewable energy sources, I will call them RES, which are scattered pretty much everywhere in the distribution level at both medium voltage and low voltage, okay? We all know that this RES pose several problems in operation, both distribution and transmission. As for now, as you have seen from the previous presentation and you will see from the next presentation, in RES dominated or low inertia power system, a major focus is, and it's right to be so, in on active power reserves, right? There are huge amounts of excellent research being conducted and looking at how fast and how deep the frequency drops in this low inertia system after an event. However, I believe, I'm not aware that a research that has been devoted to reactive power reserves evaluation during this energy transition, okay? And I believe that this, maybe it's not as important as active power reserve, but still, as you know, without appropriate reactive power reserve, one cannot transmit active power and one also face high risk of voltage instability. So, let me explain you my motivation, why I do believe that reactive power reserve would be an issue. So what I'm going to assert is that RES cannot ensure the same high quality of reactive power ancillary services as conventional power plants. And I have six arguments in favor of this statement. So first, conventional power plants were planned, as you know, at appropriate location and to face predictable operating conditions. So nothing was difficult in the power system of the past. Now, when we go to high RES penetration, this will lead to unplanned and hard to predict generation and demand patterns, which may stress the system where in places where reserves are scarce. Next, some RES, for instance, take PV panels in low voltage grids, are operating at unitary power factor and for a good reason. They need to stick to the grid code. Even more, whenever you could assume some controllability of reactive power on RES, like for instance in distribution networks, this couldn't be effective because either you end up with congestion or high losses. So basically, these reserves are involved in the management of active distribution networks. Then, I also believe that reactive power from RES is less effective for remote transmission system support because it needs to flows to different stages of transformer from low voltage, medium voltage, high voltage, and so on and so forth. So there is nothing much to be shared at transmission level. And last but not least, RES are more sensitive than conventional generators to unusual operating conditions and may disconnect take, for instance, in case of faults. And we already have the joke that RES were disconnecting, leaving the system without important megawatt and megawatt support. So what I envision is that transmission system of the future will face, I would call them extreme situations of lack or excess of reactive power and abnormal voltage profiles. And given this personal vision, this paper and this presentation seeks the so what I'm calling the breakpoint, which I mean by this, when during this the assumed energy transition, the overall reactive power reserves on conventional generators will become scarce. And the work contributions to this in response to this research question is first to raise awareness and foster research on reactive power reserve scarcity, which I believe is an issue. And second is, of course, to develop I would call it first crude methodology to address this issue. Okay. So now, in terms of methodology, at the heart of this methodology, there is a tailored AC security constraint OPF formulation, which I'm formulating it only in reactive power production mode here as a nonlinear programming problem. So the goal and the research metric of the scarcity is the minimum overall needed reactive power reserves, which are in that term, okay, over all generators in the system. In terms of constraints, I have here constraints of reactive power reserves, which are some slight modification of, let's say, usual constraint of reactive power constraints of generators, then active power constraints on generators, classical active and reactive power flow balance at nodes, branch current constraints, and voltage constraints. All of these, as we are in a security constraint OPF mode, they run for all they are postulated and formulated for all contingencies in the set C. Not that in the objective I'm also using, because this problem, the more I stress the system, the higher probability that the problem gets infeasible. So I'm just classically using here penalty terms, and I'm also relaxing a bit the reactive power reserve just to avoid numerical infeasibility. Okay. So now, as I said, this AC security constraint OPF is at the heart of the methodology, but the methodology, again, it's something that I conceive that very complex, and I just make a step, so first good step towards this. So in the first step, we need, of course, to define what we mean by energy transition scenario, right, during the time horizon. And for me, this is a series of relevant base cases, or let's say normal operating conditions of the power system. And I'm looking here only at extreme operating modes like peak load or base or light or low load, okay? These base cases are sampled in time in order to capture the shutdown of any key or big generator, okay? Sampling could be with a couple of years, okay? Then another important question is how you offset the loss of a generator. So the lost active power production, for me, it's offset by RES producing active and reactive power in the distribution grids. Then once I'm done with the scenario, I pick up the current base case. So the first one, when the first generator is supposed to be phased out. And for each, I'm solving a security constraint OPF for reactive power production mode and for reactive power absorption mode. Okay. If one of these problems is infeasible, it means that I cross the breaking point. And then it means that the system cannot operate anymore that way, and I need to take, the operator should think some var reactive power compensation plan to this. Otherwise, I'm simply selecting the next base case, so another generator will phase out, and I simply keep looping in the methodology, okay? I'm going just to present some numerical results. So to come back again to the energy transition scenario, basically, I remove one generator from service and compensate its active and reactive power production with power injections from distribution grids. For simplicity, the lost megawatts are offset at the same bus by RES production. And I also do a strong assumption that this RES production is done at unitary power factor. This is indeed very conservative, and I know it, but at the same time, we also need to have sufficient reserve available anytime in operation to avoid instability or voltage collapse. Then I would show some results with two small systems, so a five bus toy system with 5 bus, 3 generator, and 6 N minus 1 contingency, and then somehow larger but still small system, a Nordic 32 with 60 buses, 23 generators, and 33 N minus 1 contingencies. For now, I was looking only at line trippings as N minus 1 contingencies, but of course you will ask for sure why I didn't use generators, which are of course very important, and it's future work. So let's move to this small 5 bus system. You see that I have here 3 generators, and as I said, in my energy transition scenario, I'm assuming first that, for instance, this one will be phased out, and then this one. And if we look for a peak load scenario, what's going on here, you would see that voltages at all nodes after the phase out of the first generator, there is just a slow decay in voltages, but after the second one, the second generator is phased out, then the voltages dropped very low, at the very low and unacceptable values. Okay, we can see the same here for low load scenario. So here is the base case, and then we have some small over voltages, and once we phase out the second generator, the over voltages becomes clearly unacceptable. I will move now to the Nordic 32 system. In that system, this is actually the order of generators that are phased out. So I start with 1, 2, 3. So basically I'm going to, the system keeps stability up to losing 6 generators. One, I'm losing this one, the 7th, the security constraint OPF problem gets unfeasible. Now let's look how this metric that I propose, the overall needed reactive power reserves vary as we remove generators from service. So here I'm in the best case. So once I remove the first one, pretty much nothing happened. Then there is a big jump when I remove the second one. It's also, you need to think that it's a matter of mutual compensation in terms of reactive power support by different generators. If they are close to each other, then we will have this kind of behavior when pretty much nothing happens. Once you lose this and you need to import reactive power from far away, then you will get this kind of jumps. Until when I'm losing this generator G7, the red bar indicates that the security constraint OPF is infeasible. So basically I got no solution to this. Now, interestingly enough, I'm also showing the reactive power production of these generators that were phased out. And for instance, we can see that the first one in base case, so in intact operating condition, is actually absorbing reactive power, but still under contingencies, under the severe contingency, it produces some reactive power. The same happens even for G18 in that case. But after that, we see that in every case, we have in the base case, the generator produces reactive power, and this is the effective reserves, meaning by effective, only the part of the physical reactive power reserves that is needed to face and to satisfy voltage and thermal constraints into the system. Okay. Another and the last slide of numerical results shows the effective reactive power reserves of generators are phased out. Let's say basically, if we look at G15, we can see that basically, as one after the other generators are phased out, the production reactive power production is increasing. However, there are also some cases here, some weird and tricky cases where this is slightly decreasing, and this is related to, of course, to the location of the generator and also the contingency set, because each contingency stresses the system in a different area. Time for me to conclude this. So in this paper, I propose the crude first version of a methodology to evaluate reactive power reserve scarcity based on tailored AC security constraint OPF. Note that within this formulation, the optimization enables an optimal management of those reserves, because don't forget that we are minimizing the overall reserves needed over the whole system. I would say that the methodology is efficient in identifying reserves breakpoint, at least in these small cases. Something which is very important is that this methodology could inform a grid planner about the timing of reinforcing the reactive power support and also the related hotspots, which could be identified by looking at these slack variables when the problem gets infeasible. The AC security constraint of PF4 problems that I solved are non-convex and non-linear. I solved them using an interior point solver. Of course, as you know, the solution is guaranteed to be local optimum, but with numerous extensive results from literature, we know that most of the times this the interior point solver on converges to the global optimum, actually even on non-convex problems. As I said, there are a lot of extensions and refinements of the methodology, and I would enumerate plausible sequences of power plants to phase out, plausible assumptions about site of rest deployment, value of peak load, load pattern, generation demand, operation uncertainties, and also other anticipated mutations like massive deployment of non-rest distributed energy resources like batteries, demand response, and so on. Also TSO-DSO cooperation. And the last but the most important thing that I'm going to focus on hopefully this year is the VAR planning. What to do in terms of VAR support to keep track of these reserves. Thank you very much for your attention. So I just need now to take some Q&A. Okay, I was more or less in time. So Jose Daniel Lara, do you expect this to be worse where generator trips are included in the contingencies? How would you accommodate such cases in the proposed methodology? Yes, I would say I'm expecting this to get worse. For me, it was very important to have this first, I would say proof of concept. But generators could be accommodated the same way like the others. Then I saw from Professor Pekas Lopez. Oh, there are a lot of questions. I think we need to have a long thing. So renewable energy sources with power electronic converters are more and more required by grid, like STATCOM, even when there is no primary energy resource available. Do you think that the management of reactive power will get another degree of freedom in the future, provided that you have in place a coordinated reactive power management involved with TSO and DSO? Yes, this is very important to consider, as I mentioned, in the future works, TSO-DSO coordination. But as I said, I would not expect too much help in terms of what's going on in the distribution system. I think that the TSO still need to plan very, very carefully and under worst case operating conditions, the reactive power plan. Because as I said, once you have all the renewables there, once you have a fault or something weird, some weird dynamics, they may just disconnect and you leave without Megabar, so which is quite risky. Then I will take Mario Koutu. What solution should be addressed to overcome reactive power scarcity? What type of role can have the grid codes and the reactive power markets in that they're connected to the distribution grid? So it's related a bit with the question of João Pekas Lopes. solutions, as I said, I think that the TSO should to some extent rely on the DSO and what's going on in the DSO, but not too much either. I would still, because as I said, the reactive power present in distribution level does not travel far. So it's not like as we have huge pumping of megavars from big power plants directly into 400 kV transmission system. And indeed, reactive power markets is a tricky issue. I would not develop right now this. It's something to be thought of, I think. And then I think the rest of the question I pretty much replied to. Thanks for it. What do I have? Okay. Gustavo Valverde, is the scope unfeasible even with the slug variable included in the constraint? No, of course, it's mathematically feasible, but this slug will have a positive value. Okay, so basically you don't have a physical solution, but it will show some violations in terms of reactive power injections at some nodes. So basically, this is also a good way to spot where reactive power support is needed, right? By looking at this one, especially if it's concentrated in one or two substations. Okay. And I think I'm still in time for a short one from Yihui Zuo. In the context of increasing uncertainty resources, can you comment on the peaceable asset of reactive powers like battery? Right. This is very, very interesting, and we really need to make up a business case for the batteries to participate not only in active power, but also in reactive power support to the grid. Then there are still questions, but thanks a lot for very, very intense questioning to this, but I would prefer to leave the floor to other speakers, maybe towards the end, if there is still time after the last presentation, I would reply to some of these questions. Thanks a lot for all your questions.